just take a regular bucket. There you go. And we're gonna make 1 gallon of beer.
Get some sound effects, sorry about that.
What you're gonna do is you're gonna make 1 gallon of beer. So pretty much what I have over there. So we need 1 gallon of water.
Well played, sir.
That's the way to do it. And how do I know we're going to get 1 gallon of water is I'm going to use that bowl to do it. I know!
Oh, hot car.
Yay!
So you say you guys have done this before?
Yeah, we've done that before. We're used to it. We're very organized.
I am organized. Sometimes that's not good enough. Okay. Do you want one more?
Yeah.
Where is it? Where it says 1 gallon?
What tap water? Because you have chlorine in it and all different chemicals in it, you don't want that. So you can use well water, or you can use filter water, or you can use distilled water, but not tap water. Then, if I follow the recipe, let me go get my book. This 4 gallons of water and 2 ounces of dry mugwort herb. So that's for 4 gallons. I'm doing 1 gallon today. So what I need is I need basically 6 ounces of molasses. And this is the regular molasses you buy at the store. You go to Ralph, you go to Whole Foods, you go to any store. That's the only brand I've been able to find around here. Just
molasses.
What is molasses? Actually just brown sugar and pretty much until the brown sugar. You can also use maple syrup, but this is what you asked for, and there you go.
Can you use honey?
Yeah.
You want to hold this?
Oh, sure.
I will not use honey on that recipe. Why? Because honey will take much longer to ferment.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's all. Without going into the detail as to why.
Why am I holding this?
Because you look pretty, and I'm going to do something else.
Okay, you can look.
So then I take some brown sugar. And we're talking here about regular brown sugar. And it's asking for 3 pounds for 4 gallons. So I would say 3/4 of a pound for 1 gallon. I know. And this is 2 pounds. So I know it's approximately half.
But that is a pound.
And
I think this is not really
By the way, at this point, I'm not too worried about hygiene because you're going to be boiling the heck out of that thing.
But hygiene is important.
But hygiene is going to be really important for everything else once we start handling the stuff. When I make beer, I probably clean my hand every 5 minutes, every 3 minutes, every time I touch something, just so you know.
I have gloves.
Okay, so that would be approximately 3/4 of a pound. And then, following the recipe again, I'm supposed to have 2 ounces of dry mugwort herb, but because we're doing 1 gallon, so I would say 3/4 of an ounce, no, sorry, 1/2 ounce of dry mugwort. So I take my scale and I'm putting it at zero. Here's my mugwort. And being European, this is where I get lost. Afternoons. Okay, I got it. I usually calculate in grams and kilos and stuff.
Where do you get that herb?
What are we going to go get it today?
Oh, okay. Awesome.
Hi.
Hello.
And okay, so I got that right here. And this is all. So you, as you can see, it's very complex. So I've got sugar, brown sugar, I've got molasses, and I've got a bunch of dry herbs. And then we're going to close that. And then what we're going to do at this point is just boil it for 30 minutes. But what we're going to do is we're going to go for an hour, working for an hour, so this one's going to be boiling for like maybe an hour, which is a little bit of a change in the recipe, but there you go. And then when we come back, what we're going to do is remove the herb, we're going to cool down the mixture, and we're going to add some yeast when the mixture is actually cooler, and then we can put the mixture into a vessel, and I'm going to explain all kinds of different ways you can do that. Okay? So, let's go. What we brewed today is still hot, and it just looks like a very strong tea. Mm-hmm. You can smell it if you want. I mean, I don't care. I'm not going to use that beer, so we just... maybe it will end up okay, but...
Yeah.
I'm going to do it not very... not of the way I would do it at home. But you can smell it, you can try it. Or, So it's just basically sugar water at this point, where's the plant? And the plant will be at the bottom. Let me get a scoop.
That big nylon? Yeah. It's basically like I was growing mushrooms in there.
I think I will actually clean it. Soap and water or
bleach.
Bleach, thank you. I have a about bleach today, but I just don't. So you can see mugwort is right there. Typically 30 minutes. So let's just say that we didn't go on a walk and we just waited for 30 minutes. And it's been brewing for 30 minutes. Now this is too hot. So what I want to do is I want to cool it down. Because the next thing we're going to do is we're going to use some yeast. If the mixture is too hot and we put some yeast inside, we're going to kill the yeast. We don't want that. So we actually want some temperature that's good enough, which is will be we call it blood warm in Belgium. So that would be blood warm. So you, like the temperature of a body when you stick your finger in it, if you were sticking your finger in it. So what I have here is a bucket with ice, and I'm just gonna put it down to cool down. And that's probably going to take me another 10 minutes to cool down. So my next step now is I'm going to prepare my yeast. So give that over there to cool down. And then I get my little yeast packet. I get a little container that I clean too. I need my little sugar and I need some water. So I'm going to go get some water. Some water right here. When you buy the yeast, you usually set it on the label for how many gallons it is, and I know that this one is for 5 gallons. You could use the whole packet even for 1 gallon, you can't, not a problem. You're just wasting money. So what I do is I'm going to probably use around half of it at this point. I need a knife. Yeah. Anybody's got a knife?
Look at that, that's cute. Nice, nice. My knitting and my knife?
And then I just drop the yeast in the water. And I'm going to put like approximately a half a packet. And this one was safe for later, put back in the fridge. You can put it in the fridge and if you stay up to a year, right? Or like a year, something like that. The price is usually $5 per packet. But if you don't want to waste money, what you could do is actually you could reuse the yeast from the previous batch. So for example, here I wanted to show you how to make the yeast, which is very simple. So I take my yeast, some water, and I'm going to give him some food. I just take some white sugar. There you go, for food. You could use honey, you could use anything just to wake up the sugar.
Pascal, could you use a little of that sugar water if it was cool?
Yeah, absolutely.
You cook that?
Yeah. And then I'm just going to leave it there, and probably in 5-10 minutes it's going to start forming, and the yeast will react with it. So that's going to be the yeast I'm going to be using. The other method will be that when you make a lot of beer, I can take that one, pour it into the bottle, and at the bottom of it, you can see there's a lot of dead yeast and stuff. Actually, it's not dead yeast, it's actually the...
It's like dormant.
Yeah. So when this is empty, I will leave that at the bottom, and then just pour my next batch into it, and it will start fermenting right away. So you save money that way, you don't have to pay $5 every time to go buy yeast. Technically you could go on forever that way, but the reality of it is that usually after 4 or 5 batches it's going to start to change a little bit, because you, by doing it, you're probably going to have yeast from the air and different stuff, we're going to start mixing into it. Because we're not purists and we're doing primitive beer, we don't care that much, but if you wanted to do a perfect replication of a beer, like a Belgian beer or whatever, then you don't want anything into it. I do not care that much, so I don't like buying yeast anymore. Really was expensive, so I just reuse now yeast. You can also put it in the fridge, and it will keep. I've done it for like up to a month, and then use the same yeast, take it from the fridge, and then, you know, put some sugar into it, wake him up, and use that to start my next batch of beer.
How do you store it?
For me, I just put it in a Tupperware and I just put some sugar and I just leave it in the fridge.
Okay.
Do you know any other method?
That's the same thing for you.
How long does it last? I've done it for a month.
For this stuff?
Yeah, no, like if you keep the yeast in the fridge, how long does it last?
You mean the dry yeast or?
No, this one.
That one. I don't know, I mean, I would try to use it within a couple of weeks, probably.
A couple of weeks. I've done it up to a month, so it was completely fine.
Yeah.
So.
What affects the amount, the alcohol percentage?
The amount of sugar in it.
Oh.
No, if you were really, if you wanted to study beer and go to a class on how to make beer, they have all kind of instruments to calculate the amount of sugar so that they know they're going to have exactly 11 degrees based on the amount of sugar and all this stuff. But here it's primitive. We go get some wild plant, we put some sugar in it, we follow a recipe, we leave it for 2 weeks, we bottle it, we drink it, we're done. Which is really the simplicity of beer, the way it was done in the old days. Actually, in the old days, they used to make it into the clay pot. And they would never clean the clay pot, so the yeast, the live yeast, would actually live in the porous area of the clay. So when they were emptied, even a month later, they would put new batch in it, and there would still be yeast living in the clay of the pot that would restart the new batch. So whenever a pot was quote-unquote working, it would be a very valuable pot, and it's something that we'll put on the side and use it for the next batch. Okay. So right now I'm just waiting. Yes. It's a little bit cold right now, so it may take a little bit more time to waken the yeast. I'm going to wait 5 more minutes. Usually at home where it's warm, the yeast will already start forming and stuff. So I'm going to wait 5 more minutes.
Can you use raw sugar? Does it matter?
Any sugar works. Honey works, maple syrup works, molasses works. That's what you need. However, I would say follow a recipe, learn how to do things, and then you, once you've done quite a bunch, you can start experimenting yourself and try different sugar and stuff like that. Question, because I have to wait 5 minutes now, so this is boring.
So the in that pot originally you put molasses and what else did you put in there?
Well, the, water. Let's go back to the original recipe so you can write it down if you want. Because everybody's got Mugwort. So any brown sugar that you buy at the store, you can buy it organic brown sugar. 24 ounces molasses. The one that I bought is 12 ounces. So you need two of those if you make 4 gallons. You're going to need 4 gallons of water. You need 2 ounces of dry mugwort herb. And you need yeast.
How much of the mugwort?
2 ounces.
And you, it says dried, so how long did you dry it?
The way I dried it, you can do it two ways. I did some of it I did did in the dehydrator and take me a couple of hours. Mm-hmm. Not even that.
Really
hour.
Low temp.
Yeah.
You dry it until it's dry, right?
Yeah.
4 gallons.
What was the last thing that was dry?
Yeast.
No, the yeast.
Yeah.
So 1 pound.
Yeah, the yeast one. Yeah, yeast. That's what it says right there. You can also just leave it on the table or inside the closet, and it's probably going to take 3 or 4 days, if that, for the mugwort to dry. I would not leave it in the sun. Usually you don't put herbs in the sun. It's actually not good for us.
The yeast is a...
Got it?
Got it.
How about the moon? The moonlight will affect herbs?
The moonlight will take the evil spirit out of the mugwort. You will get bad dreams.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's see what's happening with...
I was asking Christopher yesterday what is another form of sugar that we could use. And he said the Indians would use fruit.
Fruit.
They would dry fruit.
Yeah.
And then pound it into a flour, and it was like sugar.
That's one way to do it.
So you could use that for making beer?
Yeah.
So you use the big bottles.
Okay, so this one.
For 2 weeks?
The what?
Do you use the gallon jugs for 2 weeks?
Oh, sorry, let me finish your recipe so you remember how to do it. So you boil the sugar, molasses, water, and herb for 30 minutes. You cool it down to 70 degrees Fahrenheit, this one.
Mm-hmm.
And then you strain into a fermenter, and this will be a fermenter right there. A fermenter is simply something where the liquid is fermenting. And we're going to talk about that just right after that. For approximately 1 week. This one has been there for actually 10 days. And you can still see it's still active.
Does it affect it, the length of time? What does it do?
The advice, when I did a lot of research on it on the internet, the advice is try not to go above 2 weeks.
That's good, like,
this, I don't know. This seems to be. I can't afford the recipe, it works every time. So I'm happy with it.
1 week?
10 days.
Oh, 10 days.
I like the 10 days. The reason I like 10 days is one batch, maybe because of the temperature, at 7 days was still a lot of bubbling going on. Mm-hmm. So I didn't feel right to put into a bulb because there may be too much pressure inside the bulb. I mean, some bottles in the beginning when I opened them, go because there's too much pressure into it. So you basically strain to the fermenter and add yeast. Ferment until complete, approximately 1 week. Then you siphon it into a bottle, prime with 1/2 teaspoon of sugar. So what the priming does is you still have some yeast that's alive in the liquid or the brew that you pour into the bottle.
You don't pour it, you siphon it with a hose?
You siphon it with a hose, and we're going to do that. And the sugar that you put first in the bottle actually helps with creating the all the bubbles inside. The what?
Carbonation.
Carbonation, thank you. Sorry. Good day today. So the carbonation, and that's why when you open it and you serve it, you actually have all this...
Sediment?
Not the sediment, the...
Suds.
No, the...
Carbonation?
Yeah, the carbonation.
The head, yeah.
Do you time sugar each bottle?
Yeah.
Each individual
half
bottle?
A teaspoon, yeah.
Half a teaspoon.
There's another method that you can do, which would be to add the sugar into the liquid before you bottle it, but I like to do it by hand like that.
I think it works better.
I agree with you.
Yeah, so I have to do it by bottle.
Yeah.
What, the half teaspoon in each bottle?
Yeah, we'll do that, yeah.
Otherwise, it's just going to end up on the bottom of the pot.
That could happen. I mean, I find it works better too. I did one batch where I put into the, and I didn't have that much pressure or carbonation. Thank you so much. Save the day.
Now, why siphon instead of pour? Does that matter? Is it just because it won't spill? Or?
You siphon it because very often with wine or beer, you have a lot of sediment at the bottom.
Ah, okay.
So you actually don't want to have the sediment. You could do it if you wanted to, but that's why
it's easier. Okay.
There is two ways to do it. There is a proper way, and there is a dirty way.
Yeah.
Today I'm going to do the dirty way, because this beer is not made for other people but for my own consumption. The proper way, there's an instrument I'm going to show you. I will use the proper way, but it doesn't stick inside the bottle. And I use a 1 gallon bottle to make experimental beer, like the white sage beer. I made some California sage beer. I'm going to make all kinds of different beers. So I like to do it in small quantities, so I don't spend a lot of money on sugar and molasses and all that stuff.
Yeah.
So I'm checking it. This is already pretty cold, so it's completely good to go. This bucket was full of ice. Then I'm going to take my yeast, and my yeast didn't do anything yet, but I know from experience that it's completely okay. Usually you will see a little bit of foaming, like the yeast is actually eating the sugar and stuff. And if I was at home, I would wait, but because I'm giving a class and I don't have to wait, I don't want to wait for 30 minutes. What you're seeing right now is foam, right?
There's foam. Yes.
Yeah.
Lots of foam.
Yeah.
Yes. Then I'm going to pour it down. I'm going to go to the kitchen. I'm going to clean this very well with bleach. If I use bleach, I rinse it 3 times. If not, I just soak and water, like soap cleaning.
What are those called?
Those are prongs.
You were calling them cooking tweezers last time.
Did I really do that?
Yeah.
So use it, the cooking tweezers. And I'm going to leave it there for maybe 5 minutes because I want to talk about something else. No, you don't want, you know, when I open it, this is when the, what we call the wort, or the soon-to-be beer, is very vulnerable to anything coming in from the outside. So you don't want to leave it open like I did for a very long time. You actually put the yeast, close it, and kind of like leave it alone. The other way to do it would be to pour the yeast in the bottles already and then you pour the liquid. Now, let's talk about this. This is called a fermenter. So basically you're going to put the yeast and you're going to put the solution here inside it for fermenting. So it's a fermenter. You can buy this at the beer store. And the little thing that you that is at the top is called a...
An airlock.
Yeah, exactly. And what it does is it actually let the gas produced by the yeast to go through, but then it does not let any air or potential yeast, bacteria or whatever to go in. So this is really good. Basically, it lets all the gas out and there is no risk of infecting your wort with bad bacteria or stuff like that. They're very cheap. They cost like, I think like what, $1.50 or $2 for one. There is different kinds. The wild beer that we do don't have a lot of bubbling going on, but some of that done with hops can really have a lot of activity going. So sometimes you use another one like that, where you put the water and same thing, pressure goes in and the air goes through the water. This one is better for wine or for low carbonation. When you have a lot of carbonation, I usually use that one. Most of the primitive beer actually low carbonation, so I like to use that one. But the good news is you don't have to go to the beer store either. In the old days, people would just take a bucket, and in this case you can go to Smart and Final and buy a food safe bucket. You just make sure you clean it with bleach or again in soap water, or if you have a machine, you just stick it in the machine and clean it there. You can put your wort in it and you take a clean towel and you just simply cover it for the same amount of time. So you cover it like that for 1 week. Gas comes in, air doesn't get in to some degree. Chance of success so far 95%. Hmm. Actually, it works 100% for me. A friend had an infection of the wort, meaning that something bad happened. But that's the way they used to do it in the old days. Grandpa used to go into the basement, put the beer there, and put the towel, and just lay it ferment like that for 1 week. By the way, from the research that I've done, when you make beer, as far as I know, there is nothing that could actually kill you if it goes bad. It just tastes bad. Mm. There's not known weird thing that will make you really sick or whatever. You just don't want to drink it just from smelling it or tasting it. So you can give it a try. You can take any recipient, glass or food safe plastic, just do what we did today, just put a clean towel and just lay it ferment for 10 days. And then you bottle it from there. Same thing as this one. This one is the most primitive. In the old days, they used to use clay pots and whatever they put on top, if they were putting even something on top of it.
Can you do it in like a 2-liter bottle if you had to?
Yes, this one, that one?
No, like a soda bottle.
You can do it in a soda bottle, but I don't like using that kind of bottle because of the chemicals involved in the plastic. But you could do it. Yeah. Some people have done it.
Yeah. If you get a bad batch, what is it? Does it look bad?
Never had a bad batch. And I use that method. What? You never had a bad batch?
No, I haven't. But it can have like a like used Band-Aids kind of a smell.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So you will not want to drink it.
Okay.
And as when I did research, it specifically said on some of the research I found that nothing in what you will drink will actually kill you type of thing. You just don't want to drink it because it's disgusting smelling or tasting.
Unless you put hemlock in it.
Unless you put hemlock beer. You don't do that too. By the way, if you really take a look at this book and all the different recipes, unbelievable the amount of plants you can use to make beer. Either beer for food, to get vitamins, or for sickness, or medicinal, or to have visions, if you want to have visions, or vivid dream. Okay, so my next phase at this point will be to take my 1 gallon bottle that's over there.
Okay.
We do the same thing that I did for that bottle, and this one we're going to use to put into bottles of beer. So, all this has been bleached, clean. I just clean my hand one more time. I clean everything all the time. And what I'm going to do now, and I'm going to need some help, is to pour the wort inside the bottle.
How important is that, I mean, to be really super, super clean?
It's very important, in the sense that that's how your beer will actually go bad. I've never tried not to be clean, but I'm pretty sure it will not work.
Yeah.
It didn't work with mead. When I did some mead, using wild yeast, 60% success, 40% failure. And I love it, because you're exposing your beer to the elements.
And the failure was just a bad taste?
Or? Oh, it didn't ferment at all, or bad taste, or, you know.
Okay.
It must be important if you start making like 10 gallons, or 8 gallons, or 20 gallons.
Yeah.
But realize, I mean, the truth is, in the old days, 10,000 years ago, they didn't have the sense of hygiene that we had.
Right.
Like in the Middle Age, beer was actually the main thing people would drink, because they didn't know about bacteria and stuff that exists in the water. So the water was actually dangerous, but they didn't know that beer was better because they boil it. So they actually pasteurized it. The only reason I put the strainer is so I don't have any herbs or mugwort going inside. Not that it's a big deal, but I would think that possibly having some organic compound in the solution may create a problem. I the specific is not to do it. So I would say, you know, you can have some.
Well, I bought beer that had a jalapeno in it. In the bottle.
I had beer that had a lizard in it when I was in Belgium.
A lizard?
Oh, wow.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And one had a mouse in it too. So.
Mouse?
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, when I was in school, when I was a kid,
we actually
had beer in school.
Yeah.
For lunch.
Yeah, it was like
20
years ago, right?
It was 1969. So in Belgium, we had beer as kids. I was like 8 or 9 years old. Uh-huh. It was non-alcoholic beer, of course.
Everybody get on their bicycles and ramp.
Almost full.
Too much?
No, but well.
Yeah, just a minute.
Yes.
So actually, when I put it into the bottle, I actually like to leave a little bit of space because you are going to have some fermentation going. And for this beer, I know there's not a lot of carbonization going on.
That's
a new one. Carbonation.
Now, is that darker because it boiled for much longer, or will it lighten up?
No, it is darker. That's the way it looks, and when the yeast start acting on it, it's actually going to turn into more reddish color.
Oh, there you go.
But the difference too is we left it for an hour and a half instead of 30 minutes.
Yeah,
may also make a difference.
Okay.
So the next phase will be for me to take my take my stopper and stick it on this one.
So you just have to pour a little water in there.
Yeah, either water. Some people use vodka too.
Oh,
you can use both. And then you just leave it for 10 days. By the next day, you should start to see those little bubbles coming up. I'm not supposed to do that. You need it open right down.
But yeah, but you have to tell everybody you talk to your bottle.
The what?
You talk to your bottle.
Yes, you have to talk to your bottle, so the gods of...
the beer gods of...
Okay, I'm crazy.
Oh, I love it.
But I can see myself talking to my bottles. They're like, come on. Yeah. Fuck it. So we're done with that step.
Cool.
Next step will be to actually bottle it. So we go forward in time for 10 days, and we get this. Everybody follow so far?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No questions?
Yeah, right here. Excellent.
By the way, that big thing that I have right here too is also a fermenter to make beer. So it's the same thing as this if you want to make like a lot of beer. And the cover has actually a little hole right there. Mm. You have to buy that at the beer store, and same thing, this thick.
Oh, so you can ferment it in the plastic?
Yeah.
It's a food grade plastic.
Food grade plastic, yeah. This one is food grade plastic too, and you can also do the same thing. I don't know if
it's not gonna stay here. It's not like.
And actually, you have a hole there, and actually, you have a little
a grommet
and a airlock, so I can use that with that one too, or you can use a towel too. Whatever lets the fermentation gas to come out, no air to come in, will work to some degree. And if you want to make beer, you can also use that.
Now we're talking.
Elderberry wine with, you know, so this, or this.
Wait, where'd you keep it?
That one is very strong. I don't want drunk people.
Oh, where'd
you keep it for the 10 days? You meant to keep it in a cupboard?
Oh, I don't put it in the sun, so I just leave it in my kitchen somewhere, maybe like a little bit darkish area, and just leave it there. I would not leave it in the sun. I forgot why.
I like why.
It skunks the beer, maybe?
Just creates some off flavor.
Creates off flavors.
The UV light, right?
We also have temperature variation.
The UV light creates changes in the flavor.
Yeah. Huh? So what sort of temperature would you just like
it's
make it a room
Evo
temperature?
Design.
I use regular room temperature. Some
it.
People will want to put it in the basement.
Yeah. Make it cooler.
Yeah. But I usually it's a dark, cool space. I use what I have. I live in California. I don't have a basement. So, kitchen. Okay. So the next phase will be to take my wort or my beer and bottle it.
So for that,
I have several bottles that are already pasteurized, cleaned with bleach, and did all kind of different stuff with it. And she should not have cleaned with bleach because he actually oxidized a little bit the metal. The next thing you're going to need is a hose.
Specialized hose.
Specialized hose that you buy anywhere at the beer store for twice the price, so you can go to Osh and buy it. It's very cheap, probably like $1 or so at the most. Again, you don't have to use a hose. If you wanted to, you can, as she was saying, take the beer and just pour it into the bottle, and that will work too. And you would just simply take the...
What is it? The stopper?
No. What do you need for that fee? So you would take the fennel and then pour it into the bowl. But before we do that, at this time I'm going to add my half a teaspoon of white sugar into the bowl. Why do I use white sugar? I use brown sugar and the carbonation was not that good. Who is it? I went to use white sugar and I had a better carbonation.
Honey?
Where do you buy those bottles?
You buy those bottles at the beer store.
You can order them online.
The reason I buy those bottles, by the way, is because a lot of the... Well, one, when I started doing this stuff approximately a year ago with elderberry wine and all that, or 3 years ago, I didn't know what I was doing. So... If you have too much fermentation and gases, your bottles actually can explode because there's too much pressure. However, those ones are so thick that they actually you can tremendous amount of pressure is still. I've not known of any of those bottles exploding. And I remember I did a batch, I had put too much sugar and it was still fermenting. And when you open it, man, they're like. But those balls didn't break in any issue. And sometimes, actually, there was so much pressure, I remember going to sleep and you hear this in the corner, and I look and it came from one of the bottles. So, yeah, that was a lot of pressure.
How about crystallized honey? Evaporated quite a bit of
the problem is honey is the kind of sugar that's in it, which is a mix of fructose and glucose. The glucose is faster for the yeast to digest and process. The fructose takes much longer. Mm. So when you make honey, you're talking about months of fermentation, not weeks or days. So I take my little sugar. And what I would have done is I would have cleaned the siphon and dried, but I cannot do it here, so I'm just going to take it. And then just go up. Half a teaspoon per bottle.
No, I'm not writing. It's making me unhappy.
And I'm going to clean it to make sure I get a nice seal afterwards. Hey. And that's where I get dirty.
Yeah.
So the beer that you drink today didn't use that system. I use another system here. And you can, give me the big tube, please? Yeah. So the big tube thingy is to basically help siphon the beer without having to stick your mouth into it. And the way it works is you kind of like, actually, you can buy that also at the beer store, but I don't like to spend money, but I did it because I serve beer to other people, so it would be nice to do that for you guys. And usually you put this into the bucket, you open it, put this into the bucket, and then you push it down and you have fluid or the beer going through the tube, and you can start siphoning that way without having to go put saliva all over the place. But if you make beer for yourself, you don't like kissing yourself.
So you're only giving yourself.
Your mouth is there all the time, and you're using the same saliva. So let's go down and dirty. What I'm going to do now is this thing, and then I must take my bottle inside, right here. Take my bottle, and I'm gonna go to. Remember, you didn't drink that. Uh-huh. And there you go.
Thank you, darling.
Every time I move. Wait, you had a long hose.
And the reason I put it in a container is every time you change from one bottle to the other, you actually don't put it all over the floor.
And you don't really want the tube to go to the bottom, right?
No, you're trying to avoid the bottom because you're going to suck all the yeast. Mm-hmm. I think it's yeast poop at the bottom, right?
So then you could just pour in a new batch to the to the fermenter.
Yeah.
Without adding yeast.
You use a yeast poop.
Now, would you need to do that right away? I mean, we're talking about cleanliness, and I mean,
I would do that right away. Like, you know, if you do a lot of beer, I would do one batch after the other. But you can also put it into.
Sorry.
Thank you. You can also put it into a pickle and stick it in the fridge for a couple of weeks. So.
Oh, so like, you just don't take it and leave it. Liquid,
no,
maybe
I would take it. I would take it
and then pour it out.
I would take it, take some of it, and then put it into a Tupperware in the fridge and keep it there for 2 or 3 weeks, maybe a month.
Okay.
What? No, no, no.
So it's not really super solid, stuck at the bottom. It's still pretty liquid.
Yes.
Sediment.
Yeah, you'll see. So 1 gallon is usually good for 6 bottles. Do you want to get some cups?
Yeah.
I usually leave this mushroom at the cup. Yeah. So you
have
some gas. I look for some fresh sugar. Okay. Okay, guys. So, by the way, you had the Mugwort beer that was aged. If you want, you can actually literally take that one, which is not even put into bowl, and try it. It's not as good, for sure. And you're actually drinking live yeast, but so are you doing when the beer is old anyway.
Yeah.
But you don't have any of the carbonation yet, or very little, if you want to try it. Actually, Mia, do you want a fork or something? So on my side, what I'm doing at this point is I'm emptying a little bit. I want to leave a little bit of space. This is my space. I close it. And I'm going to leave it somewhere for weeks, months. Usually it says you can drink it after 2 weeks. But as Mia was saying, you know, the Shtf beer was kind of like, after 10 days. 4 months later, it is much better.
Mm. Oh, interesting.
So it's good to let it age. Mostly with the Mugwort beer and the...
How long did you let it age in the bottles?
2 months.
Wow, okay.
The one you had today was 2 months, 2 or 3 months.
Mm-hmm. Like a maximum start.
Do you know, I don't know what the maximum amount of time is. So far, I've not had one beer than that.
Really? How long did you leave it?
3 months for Mugwort and 4 months for white.
Oh, so I guess any beer I'm making now, I'm not going to show you. Sorry.
I don't know if anybody ever needs to try.
Wait, the one that we had over there was just a 10-day?
No, that was 2 months.
Or that
two months.
2 months.
No, the Shtf was what?
4 months.
4 months.
Oh, and the Mugwort was 2 months.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
And how old is this one? Like, it's brand new, right?
This is brand new.
Yeah. Yeah.
Last week?
10 days. Yeah, 10 days and 4 months.
You guys want to?
Mm-hmm.
Want to try?
So this was fermented but not bottled.
Right. Not aged or anything.
Okay. That's not very carbonated.
That would be so awesome if we had
like big parties. Well, if we're actually basically sit on
the door and then just close it up and move. Yeah.
Okay, so you had a question. You say, I want to take the yeast from this bottle and I want to reuse it for the next one. Take it, shake it. You can see the poop at the bottom there.
Oh, wow.
The yeast poop?
Yeah.
So you mix. A poop is a fantastic fertilizer. So you use the poop to fertilize the next beer. But that's the way we'll do it. And then you save that in the fridge.
Okay.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay,
so you add sugar to it when you put it?
You want to feed it a little bit. Feed it a little bit of sugar from time to time if you want. But usually when you put it in the fridge, the temperature is so low that it's just
dormant.
Okay.
But if you want to wake him up, then you add sugar to it. And you will see it. Like even if it's been like fresh beer, it's not fermented like within an hour.
So you don't have to worry about it starting to carbonate.
That's how I said.
Yeah.
And you're like, yeah. I am like, oh, look.
That's it.
Awesome.
Yay.
Thank you.
Yay.
So everybody's got Mugwort, everybody's gonna make beer, right?
Yep.
Yes.
So let's talk hangovers.
Well, what's the percentage of alcohol do you think in
I don't know. Right, my evaluation from drinking beer will be 7 degrees maybe.
Oh.
What do you think? From 7%, yeah. What do you think?
I would like to drink 4 or 5 minutes.
I'm not. I mean, that's too much.
I've never gotten tipsy from it though.
I'm buzzed.
Really? Yeah.
Oh, I'm not tolerant.
Everybody's gonna have a nice dream tonight.
I get tipsy.
He had like an incredible experience.
I think the elderberry. I also got this wine from me. It was like 27 tips.
Yeah. Whoa.
Yeah. Like I got
that's good.
So we have that.
Yeah.
When you go to the beer store, there's all kind of gadgets that they wanna sell you and stuff. This is for cleaning bottles. But as you can see, I've been making elderberry wine for over a year. I never used it, ever. So I just, whenever I do a batch, I just clean my bottle right away. And I don't need to like...
What do? You just put soap in there and swish it around? And,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And let it dry and there you go, store it. Never had any problem. And then when I do a new batch, you know, clean it thoroughly and I mean, you can if you want to, but I never had to use it so far.
More stuff to buy.
Yeah.
Which, so how did you choose which yeast?
I went to the beer store and I said, just give me the most common beer yeast you can think of. That's how I chose. There's so much experiment to do.
Right. Have you tried different yeast?
No, not yet.
Champagne yeast, right?
The what? I use champagne yeast for elderberry yeast, but no, I don't use.
Yeah, I use that for
Have you tried your elderberry yeast?
The what?
Elderberry with the champagne? Is it good?
I did two kinds. Regular recipes, and the one that's more like a wine is still aging, it's getting better as it ages. But it's more like a cocktail. You drink it like a cocktail with like a lime, and it's really strong.
What, the elderberry wine?
Yeah, it's like a liqueur.
Wow.
What did you do?
I looked up on the website, I have the recipe there.
Wow.
I think I used
the champagne.
Smell it.
It's like our house is like...
I looked it up.
Yeah.
That's
awesome.
From trees over here. In June.